Livingston Family Dentistry knows the value of a healthy, beautiful smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston and their friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. So whether it's routine dentistry, cosmetic improvement, or complete restoration, bring your smile back to life at Livingston Family Dentistry, located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park. Call now, 313-883-3050. If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.
Good morning, and welcome to the Brenda Perryman Show right here on TV 33, WHPR, Comcast 91 in Detroit, all over the world, courtesy of the World Wide Web. And today is so special. I have a legend here, previously unsung, but he's going to be sung today. And I have Mr. McKinley Jackson. Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm doing well. Doing well. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. It's so good to have you here. I mean, I'm a music lover. A lot of my people are music lovers. Mr. Jackson has a long history of things. You might have heard those people who were like from back in the day, like myself, heard of McKinley Jackson and the Politicians. Or was it the Politicians featuring McKinley Jackson?
It was both, actually, but I think the record itself came out as the Politicians featuring McKinley Jackson.
Yeah, I always heard of McKinley Jackson and the Politicians.
Well, that's the way we worked around Detroit for years and years, but for some reason when the record came out, it was the Politicians featuring McKinley Jackson.
Oh, that was great. Now, McKinley, you were born here in Detroit?
Exactly. Absolutely. Right here in Detroit, right on the North End.
North End. East Side?
Well, right, Oakland and Orange, right down the street from Elma and Carl's, if you remember.
Oh, I remember hearing about it. Elma and Carl's record shop.
That was one of the premier record shops at that time, and White's record shop, and Phelps is right around the corner, as a matter of fact.
Phelps Lounge?
Phelps Lounge. It wasn't even called Phelps at the time. I think it was called Berserdi's. And I used to go outside the club and stand in the alley with my trombone and play. The Funk Brothers were inside playing. And I would stand in the alley and take my trombone and play along with them. Because I remember when I got to be 18, I put on a straw hat and stuff and walked in the front door. They said, if you don't get out of here, because they knew me from playing at night. But I thought, so I'm 18 now, so I can just walk in and order me a beer or something. They kicked me out. So,
how did you take an interest in playing?
Well,
music.
I didn't have an interest in too much other things as a kid, other than the church, I think, perhaps. But a friend of mine, Charles Thomas, I remember his name, we were in junior high school, And I think we went tit for tat in everything we did. So he said, I'm in the music class. I said, so am I. I joined too, but I hadn't. And I ran around the school, and I ran up the other side of the school and went to the music room. And the only thing left.
What school was that?
That was that particular school was Sherrod Junior High School. That's mm-hmm. right. Mr. Gordon Allen was the teacher, and they were out of all the instruments, trumpets and saxophones, all the, what do you call them now? Not sexy, but excuse me. But the instruments the girls liked, you know, saxophones and trumpets.
Okay.
The only thing left was a trombone. So I took it and fell in love with it. Fell in love with it. Absolutely fell in love with it.
You were a quick learner?
Pretty much so. I think I excelled at that. That was something I excelled in. Not so much sports or too many other things, but I excelled at that right away. And my arms were long, so I could reach all the positions.
Okay. Yeah, I just found that out. Paul Reiser had told me that your arms had to be a certain
length. Yeah, because you got 7 positions. So I could do this and have 7 positions. A lot of guys would get to 6, and they would have to go over like this to get 7, but I could just stand there and do this, you know. And so.
Wow.
I was naturally made
so
for trombone.
Well, in high school, I think you told me something like you'd sneak off and play.
I would. That's how I got to Motown. Skipped school one day and went to, I was called at the, I had a recall for a session at Motown. And I went over there, and the recording session was for Ooh Baby Baby.
Ooh.
And I played on that. I think it was 3 trombones. I mentioned that the other 2 people passed now, and that was George. That was Don White and Bob Cousard, mm-hmm. or the other trombonists. And
do you know what a landmark song that was?
I found out later. I was in L.A. and I think I was writing, and the guy said it was recorded in '63, and this must have been in the '90s or something. I said, "Wow, am I old?" Because I hadn't heard the record for years, and I didn't know what year it was.
Well, the record was short. It was like under 2 minutes.
That's right. Well, all of them were back at that time.
Well, it was because it was that song, yeah. But I remember at the parties, we'd start dancing, and by the time it got good, the record was off, so they'd automatically play it another time.
That might have been part of the thinking.
Oh.
But no, back at that time, just for the radio, you had to be under 230. When you got to things like What's Going On, those things, and Stevie were groundbreaking, because all records were if it was 231, you would go in there and splice the tape, or you would put on the record 230, even if it was 231.
Really?
I mean, really, nothing could be over 230. 215, 220, 225 was ideal. 230 was stretching it.
How long my girl was. I need to know.
I bet you it's not much. If it's over 230, it's not much over 230.
I don't know.
Because it's pretty, that was well arranged and well produced and well written. And, you know, you got your chorus, you got your 2 verses.
Well, there's a video that's going on around the internet. In fact, I have it on my page. And it has Inside the Studio and David up there starting off singing
Okay.
It has Smokey's behind them.
Oh, yeah.
And he's like giving directions and stuff.
Okay.
I hadn't seen that until about 2 weeks ago. Okay. So that was very, very interesting. And it showed the violinist. It showed the trumpet player.
The brass players right in the same room. I think on that particular picture, weren't the Dozier's and weren't the Holland Brothers standing around too?
Not that one.
Oh, not
the
one
you're talking about is the one where, Remember Me.
With David singing that.
Yeah, that's the one, Holland Dozier. They were standing around, and Ivy Joe Hunter did the count.
Yeah, he
did the count.
Okay, right.
Mm-hmm.
Ivy Joe, another talented undersung person from Motown.
I want to get him on the show. I think I can. I used to see him quite often. I was his son's acting teacher, drama teacher.
Okay.
And he would come in to bring something for Keith, and I say, oh, it's good to see you. He says, it's good to be seen.
right. And not you, that's what we used to say.
Yeah, right. I don't even want to say that part. Yeah. So how did you get into Motown, become a part of Motown?
Well, actually, it stemmed from that session. Then they started calling me for more sessions, and then I would start to go out on the road with the big band, Choco Campbell's big band. And then we, that was it. Everybody from Motown was on that bus. Everybody except for Marvin Gaye, whom I worked with later. But everybody was on the bus. I mean, Stevie Wonder.
Wasn't he a part of the Motown?
Yeah, but he was. But he would be maybe doing like the 20 grand. And they might keep back the spinners because, you know, Marvin was stage frightened at that time.
Was he?
Oh, he never loved the stage, you know. It's just something he had to do. He was very stage frightened, very reluctant. But, you know, once you put him out there.
When he got older, he sure was a stage fright.
That was true. That's when I was with him. He was more of He was more in tune with it then because he was competing with the younger generation. But you know, he started out to be a ballad singer. You know that, right?
I think they said that he loved the ballads.
Ballads, Frank Sinatra. I mean, that's the type of thing.
Well, I have an album with him. He said, "I've grown accustomed to her face."
Yeah. So that was his love. You know, they had to kind of goose in the play to do Hitchhike and those types of things.
Yeah, he always seemed awkward doing that.
That wasn't his thing at all. You know. Marvin was, again, one of a kind, but everybody was on that bus except the Supremes and Marvin. And sometimes they would take the spinners to back up Marvin at the 20 grand.
Oh, okay.
But Stevie was on the bus, Temptations, Four Tops, Vandellas, Martha and Vandellas, and Marvelettes, and Willie Tyler and Lester.
Mr. Henry Tyler's brother,
Yeah, he's one of the best, I think, that's ever done it.
I do too.
Yeah, really,
and
sincerely.
And we were really happy to see a black man be a ventriloquist.
I know, and an excellent one. Excellent. I mean, I was right there, and I never could detect him.
Have a phone call. We have Jimmy on the line. Okay. Good morning.
Yes.
Hi.
Yes, Jimmy A. Good morning.
Good morning.
Mackenzie Jackson, I remember about 40 years ago, out of the Mount Royal Hotel, Charlie Long Jr., when he tried to play the drums, and you was playing the trombone.
That's right.
Group then, you know what I mean?
That's
formed the group at the Mount Royal Hotel in the basement.
That's it.
I spent the record at the 20 grand with Freddie Cannon Dern. Jimmy
Ames. Oh, Jimmy.
You remember me,
McKinley? Jimmy Ames. Sure, I remember you. Jimmy.
Yeah.
Ernie and Udi Koo.
Yeah.
How you doing, Jimmy? It's been many years. Yeah. Many years.
Okay.
Yeah, as a matter of fact.
I'm fine.
Great.
Hey, McKinley, I'll be
82 now. You're 82 now?
Yes.
Whoa, yes. Well, listen.
It's been some years. You was 15 years old when I met you.
That's right. I was about 15 to 16.
Yeah.
Good talking to you, Jimmy.
Okay.
I hope we can get back to see each other.
Okay, Kelly.
Okay, bye.
All right, thanks a lot.
All right. can I tell you something?
Yes.
Jimmy and Ernie and Udi Koo, and he mentioned the Mount Royal Hotel. Well, I think I mentioned to you that I was with a show with Nina Simone.
Yes, you did.
And that's when I won the Tasty Bread back there, Tasty Bread Talent Contest. And so we're about 15 or 16, and the name of the group was the Mount Royal Clips because of the Mount Royal Hotel. And the drummer's father owned it. And so we rehearsed there. So that's why we see Ernie and Udi Koo and Jimmy. So that goes a long way back.
Sounds young.
Yeah, hey, I know. 82.
Real good. Well, we have another call. We have Tina on the line. Good morning, Tina.
Hi. McKinley won't remember me, but I remember him. He was an upperclassman at Northern High School. And I can remember him at lunch period. If you can remember now, McKinley, they would let you guys go in and practice on stage. in the auditorium. Do you remember that?
I most certainly do, because
I can remember you on the trombone playing Tenderly almost every day practicing. And I've watched your career, and I'm just very, very proud to have remembered seeing you during high school. And I want to ask you, whatever became of Kenny Rice, who also used to be there on the drums all the time? Is he still active, or what became of him?
His last name was White?
Rice, R-I-C-E, right. Kenneth Rice. I think they called him Spider.
Oh, Kenneth Spider.
Yes.
Yeah, Spider is still active, very active. He plays with Bill Myers around town at Burt's. You'll find him around. And Spider went on to do quite a few different things in Los Angeles. We both lived in Los Angeles for a while. And excellent. Spider is still very active, and he's an excellent drummer then and now.
I remember his solo on Eddie Kendrick's Keep On Steppin'.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Keep On Truckin'. Keep On Truckin'. Yeah, Keep On
Truckin'. Keep On Truckin'. Yeah, Keep On Truckin'. Yeah. But I just remember so vividly well during lunch period coming in and watching you play Tenderly on your trumpet.
Well, you know, I used to get in trouble, too, because I was supposed to be in class. But I would be in the auditorium, as a matter of fact, and some of the classes would be in the seats, because that was their what would you call it, lunch
study
hour
break.
Hall. Study
lunch
hall,
hour
study
break.
Hall.
Yeah.
And so I would be down there almost every hour. I mean, seriously, either I would be in the class and I would drop my mouthpiece, so they would tell me get out of here. So and I would go down and play in the auditorium. So and that's
yes,
a long
you
way
did.
Back to
I remember. And you look great, and it's so good to see you.
Oh, thank you so much.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much.
Bye bye.
Okay, bye bye.
We should say right now, he is the Temptations musical director, Otis's Temptations.
That's correct.
Right?
That's correct. And actually, I'm glad you qualified that, because there are other Temptations around.
Right.
I always say that the formerly of, wish I was, would like to be Temptations, but there's only one group of Temptations legally that can use that Temptation. That's Otis Williams.
Right.
And that's who I'm with, and we're doing quite well now. We have some new singers involved. One is Larry Braggs from the Tower of Power.
Oh, really?
He's with Tower of Power for 11 years. Excellent singer. Probably one of the best they've had since Lenny Williams left the group. And then we have a bass singer, Willie Green, out of Las Vegas, and he's been with Lyle Lovett, George Harrison, quite a few various acts.
Well, who's doing Eddie's part?
That's still Ron Tyson. He's been
he's still
Ron's still there, still holding fort,
good.
And still in good voice, very good voice. And there's one more member that I should mention. That's Terry Weeks, and Terry does everybody's voices. He can do all of them.
Somebody,
really? Yeah. If anybody gets sick, Terry will do the part. He's an excellent singer, Terry Weeks.
Well, I'm gonna have to go see them if they ever come in this area.
Well, we'll be in this area. On January the 27th and the 28th.
Where?
At the Andiamo's in Celebrity Room in Warren, Michigan, 14 Mile Road, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, well.
We'll be here.
I'm going to have to make sure that I get there to see.
Yeah. So we'll be here. They generally bring us in for one night, but I see this year they're bringing us in for two nights, so I guess we do pretty well there.
Oh, well, that's great. Yes. You know, it's like people can't get enough of that Motown sound either, because Motown, didn't you think they had a distinctive sound?
Oh, for sure. You know, speaking of Temptations and Motown, when we do shows now, it's always packed. Very seldom is it not packed.
And you go overseas a lot.
We go overseas. Oh, that's another thing. They just love it over there. We just came back. We were in the UK for about 3 weeks, and we're going to Australia with the Beach Boys and February, then we're going to Hawaii, I think, right before we go to Australia.
Oh, wow.
So, but what happens, and you talk to people and you see them, people my age, then they have kids and they have grandkids from there. And they all know Motown because they play around the house. And,
yes.
And it's often been said, and it's very true, that Motown's like the tapestry of these people's lives.
It is. It really is.
It is.
Take it from me.
Yeah, it is.
My producer, Michelle, that you just met,
yes.
She knows how much I love Motown. It was no joke. I mean, it was just like our lives. You know, we're teenagers, you know, falling in love, doing this, going to school, and learning to dance. It was.
And you have to realize, too, at that time in the 60s, even in terms of race relationships, it helped bring that together. Because before there, a lot of the groups in Motown refused to play if it was segregated. And if they wouldn't play unless they allowed the audience to be collectively seated. And so you have to realize, and then people were listening to the music, they were dancing to the music, and they were having the, because before then, you know, they would have records out and they would have white faces on the.
Right.
On the album. So, I mean, that was just the time it was at that time. But Motown broke a lot of that down, I think. You know, well, for sure they did.
Well, I'm hoping we could put the phone number across the screen because I know that we have some people who are watching who don't live here in the area and might want to call. And it's, you know, you just ask for something and there it is.
Oh, I see.
You just ask and there it is. But when did you first saw David Ruffin where?
Here in Detroit, and that's before, as I mentioned before, the Temptations. David was singing around town, and he had, I think, Fortune Records. I think it's with the Fortune Records who had Nolan Strong. Nolan Strong and then Diablos. And the Diablos.
Mind Over Matter.
Mind Over Matter. And also Village of Love. Nathaniel Mayer. And David was there too. And I'm not sure if the records I'm thinking about were on that label, but he was with that label. And that was Please, Mr. Bus Driver. And this guy was singing. That's when I first heard him. Hadn't met him yet. And this guy said, this is a tremendous, tremendous singer here. And the storyline was he was in a hurry to get to his lover, his love.
Yes.
And at the end of the record got faster and faster and faster. And I never heard anything like that before because the bus was like, please, hurry, hurry, hurry. And the record got faster and faster. I thought it was so unique.
Because he was chasing after the bus.
Yeah. So.
Well, another one he did that wasn't, I don't think it was with Motown. I saw it later, was called Statue of a Fool.
Statue of a Fool. I remember
and
that,
at
sure.
At the end of that, he started posing in these different statues, poses.
But David's one of the great entertainers, entertainers. And I haven't seen anybody yet that could do, out of the Joe Texas, Jane Brown, David had a unique style in terms of stage presentation. He's one of the best at flipping the mic in the air, turning around, doing the flip, falling to the floor, and then catching the mic.
I'm about to faint just thinking about it because there's sometimes I watch the CDs. Well, you know, I used to teach, so when the Temptation story came out and they were just getting on buses, going on tours, on the movie.
Yeah.
My students had watched, and I taught high school. And so I said, wouldn't it be great to do something like that? They said, yeah. So I said, you got to learn the Temptation steps and everything, which they did. And it was always that special dancer, entertainer student who could do the things that David did because he really was special. And he did little things like crooking his head everything.
Just, I mean, David was just, his whole energy was, he was like that on and off stage.
Oh, really?
I mean, you know, he had that personality, you know. I mean, he'll tell you, I'm the best in the room.
Oh, really?
I mean, with anything, he would say, I'm the best. And he was the best, you know.
Who were, you did the studio too,
sure,
right?
Sure, yeah.
So who were the people who were easy to come in there, they just did their work? What had they studied early? Because some of the ones, there's not a lot of clippings from back then in the studio, in that Studio A or
Studio
whatever.
Studio A, that's correct.
And but did they come prepared or what?
They came prepared, but I tell you, it's often been said of the assembly line, and it was. And it's much like a school also. And they had a school because that's what they had, Charlie Atkins, who would the choreography. So any Motown act would be excellent in terms of choreography. They had Miss Miss Powell.
Powell, Maxine Powell.
Maxine Powell's, in terms of, which I probably could use as far as diction and speaking and just poise and for the Supremes and stuff, all they had, and those was mandatory that they went to those classes. So that's part of the whole Motown regime. But also, you had great talented musicians, for sure, the Funk Brothers. But then you had talented producers, too, that knew what they wanted and knew how to get it. And you had a company that was dedicated to the talent, to get the best talent out there, not just put out a record and sell so many, and then we'll put out another one and sell so many. You had a company that was dedicated to excellence.
You know, it's interesting. You may, when you were talking about it, I thought about the Supremes, Butter Popcorn, and these little songs.
Yeah.
I remember, for some reason, we were so excited. I bought all, even though they weren't hits, we bought all those little
local
45s.
Local hits, yes. I mean, I talk to people now, and they don't know certain records that we know here. I can tell who's from Detroit. When I'm on the road, I can tell who knows Detroit, who studied Detroit. But you'd be surprised, overseas, they have really, really done their homework over there. They know everything. I mean, here we are more star oriented. They want to know who's in front, who's singing lead, who's doing this.
Right.
But over there, they want to know who's in the background, who played the trombone, who played the trumpet, who played the bass. Oh, very much so. And I learned that many, many years ago. I went over there many years ago and did some projects for EMI. As a matter of fact, speaking of Paul Reiser, I think Paul couldn't do that when he asked me to go in his place, and I went over. And it was a group called Gonzalez, and Gloria Jones, who's from here, and she was married to T-Rex then, one of the biggest groups in the UK at that time. Mm-hmm. I think, unfortunately, he had an accident in the past, they were former Motowners. Just that the fact of the matter is, they all wanted to know about Jameson. What kind of hat did he wear? How did he sit when he played the
really?
Bass? You know, what kind of pick did he use? What kind of pipe did he smoke? I mean, they wanted to know everything and anything about him. And I found that, I said, that was so refreshing, you know, to see people that really cared.
Well, we listened. I think the way we listened, I'm going to bring up the Temptations. I don't want to harp on the Temptations,
okay.
even though they're my
that's
favorite
okay.
group. But okay. we can hear Eddie's voice, we knew how to differentiate the voices on that.
Sure. Well, they're all unique. That at the time, Inception, that was a very unique group because you had Paul Williams.
Oh, goodness, a great baritone.
Great baritone, and had the things progressed differently, he could have been in Vegas singing right along with Sammy Davis and Paul.
He was the most excellent dancer.
Dancer, and of course, and personality. He had the personality.
Yes.
Then you had David, who was a completely different personality, and Eddie Kendricks, the mild-mannered, excellent vocalist. And then you had, Melvin and I went to school together. We went to Northern High School together.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. And I could be
but
down.
But he was older than you.
Oh, he was older. We didn't get into that, but he was much older. But he was still in high school when I got there. I'm not sure if I didn't go a year earlier. But Melvin, I could be in one part of the school, and Melvin could, without projecting or being loud, he could just say, "Hey, how you doing?" And you could hear it reverberate through the whole school. "Hey, how you doing? How you doing?" And that was one of the best true bass singers I've ever heard in my life.
Who was the other?
Well, I'm telling you, strangely enough, the guy that used to sing on Lawrence Welk. He had a great voice. He used to sing Old Man River and stuff on Lawrence Welk show. As a kid, I used to watch everything. Guy Lombardo, Count Basie, Duke Ellington, whomever it was, I would watch.
We have another call. We have Joe on the line. Good morning.
Good morning. And good morning to your guest, Brenda.
Oh.
I wanted to ask you a question, young man. During your tenure at Motown, what year did the rhythm and blues and rock band Rare Earth start playing with you guys? And was the president's decision made to employ Rare Earth based on you guys being jazz musicians and, you know, really rock musicians in your own right. And, of course, Dennis Coffee played, too, but he came a bit after Rare Earth. And I just want you to reflect on how the Funk Brothers and you guys really influenced the rock and roll and the jazz world.
Well,
all right, thanks for taking my call, Brenda.
Thank you for calling.
Well, first of all, you know, the Funk Brothers were jazz players working in nightclubs around the city. And actually, that's a little before me, because I think I was telling Brenda, I used to stand outside the clubs with my trombone, and I'll be playing in the alley while they were playing inside. So it's a little before me, but I do know the story. Fortunately, I remember the Rare Earth before they were Rare Earth, because I worked a lot of the clubs, the supper clubs, with Danny Woods, who went on to be part of the chairman of the board later. But they were called the Sunliners, and they got signed to Motown, and that's when they started doing recuts of the Temptations thing, I think.
Yeah.
Get Ready. We spoke about that earlier.
Yeah.
But it was a hit, and the guys were a good group. They were a cover group, and they worked at Gino's Supper Club out in the suburbs. I'm not sure. I don't remember exactly which one, but they were a good group, and they brought them into Motown. And Harry Balk, who was 91, just passed, and Harry Balk is the guy they brought in to do the Motown label, which was a Rare Earth label. Named after the group.
Yes.
He just passed. But Dennis Coffee has been around for quite a while, because before, even while I was with Motown, I was independent. The Funk Brothers were basically under contract, or at least an agreement that they were Motown musicians, for the most part exclusive. But I was independent, so I did a lot of sessions around town. Dennis Coffey was around, so was Bob Babbitt, who became a Funk Brother later, and Ray Monette, who was part of the Rare Earth. We used to produce records for other companies, so I had a history with the Rare Earth and back at that day, and naturally a history with the Motown. So the genesis there is just kind of a natural thing, because, you know, even in the Funk Brothers, there was Robert Pingpong, who's a Caucasian, and there was Joe Messina,
right,
from Canada, who's even though it was a black company, there were Caucasian people,
right,
working it, and it was just a collective thing. So it wasn't like, even when I mentioned it before, it was a black company ran by a black person, but the music itself was universal, and it was generated in a universal way, because whoever could contribute would, and so the music reflected that too, I think, mm-hmm. You know. So the Rare Earth was a great group. They came along, and they're still, some of the guys are still left. Some have passed, I think. But
well, outside of Motown, you've done other producing, and you've worked with so many. Can you tell the audience some of the people you've worked with?
Yeah, I tell you, well, R&B, even Motown, and when the Holland Dozier and Holland left Motown, I was the first act to sign with them, because they took me along to be their Funk Brothers, the politicians, you know. Little do I know at the time, I thought they were signing as an artist. I thought it was going to be an artist, but they really wanted us to back the records up. And so therefore, they created Chairman of the Board.
Is that giving me just a little more time?
Yeah.
I was in college. I remember that.
Yeah, well, see, a lot of the groups then, and She's Not Just Another Woman. 100 Proof, I think, Age of Soul.
Yeah,
that was Steve Matchin sang a lead. But there were no groups. That was the politicians playing the music, and they would find singers to sing on top of the music.
Oh,
so
okay.
That was the way Holland Dozier and Holland did it. They created the music first, then they find an act and put it on there and name the act. Like, that's what happened to Chairman of the Board, Glass House. I mentioned 100 Proof, The Eighth Day, Crawl Before You Walk with Melvin Davis.
I want to get Melvin Davis on my show. Well, I finally friended him on Facebook.
Well, I can give you his information because we work together anytime I'm in Detroit and there's something going on with Melvin, I'm probably involved in it. And Joe Pep and Spider Turner, we all work together.
Well,
Pat
I've had
Lewis,
Joe
Pat
Pep
Lewis,
on the show.
Pat
and,
Lewis.
Pat Lewis, I know Pat Lewis through
Hot
Facebook
Butter Soul.
And all that.
Yeah, Hot Butter Soul. So we all do a lot of shows together, but yeah, okay.
So when did you start producing?
Well, when I left Holland Dozier Holland in 73, August.
McKinley Jackson, everyone. you left them.
Yeah, I went to ABC Dunhill Corporate in Los Angeles, in California. Lamont Dozier and myself, that's when they kind of split up. The Holland Dozier Holland split up, and Lamont Dozier went to California. Well, Popcorn Wally.
I'm going to ask this question. Eddie Holland, did he just stop performing after, like I told you, I remember Jamie.
Jamie, yeah.
Talking about Jamie. Yeah. But that's my girl.
Yeah,
I had to get the rest
of
that. But did he just, like, he preferred producing and writing?
Oh, yeah, he'll tell you the story. I just spoke that with a couple of days ago. He'll tell you the story. First of all, he'll tell you that when he looked at his check, I saw the difference between what he made as an artist and what he made as a producer and writer. There was no question about it. The other thing is this. He did not like performing at all. He didn't like being on stage at all. He had a great voice, and, you know, he did a lot of demos for Jackie Wilson because Barry's producing Jackie, and that's how the connection started there. Along with from Janie Bradford, I think she connected them all up. But Ed will tell you, he hated performing, but he loved writing. And if you listen to most of the songs, even the Four Tops and Supremes, if you listen to them carefully, you can see how Edward would put down the demo track, and they would more or less sing it exactly
like
Edward was singing. Yeah, so his thing is out there. I tell you, it's kind of funny, but when I was younger and I was studying, I would study records, and I would sometimes speed a record up. There was a Four Top record. Probably happened just one time, and I said, wow, it sounded like Supremes. And then I would take a Supreme record and slow it down. And I said, wow, that sounded like the Four Tops. And then I realized after I started working with Edward now, they all sounded like Edward.
Oh, okay. Wow.
I didn't realize that until I started working with Edward and heard him dubbing in and have the singer sing exactly like he would sing it. And I see the phrasing and the way, and they wrote a certain way. And when Edward writes, you have to sing it the way he articulates it, because that's part of the melody. That's part of the lyric. It all has an interconnecting.
Interesting, because I think Paul Reiser told me once that Holland Dozier Holland put their hook at the beginning, and Smokey put his later on
he built the verses up to the
yes
hook. And Holland Dozier Hollywood do many things. They might put a hook at the beginning, they might put the beginning at the end, at the beginning, I mean, whatever worked, because they were that way. They were like mad scientists in a sense. And Brian Holland was like the analytical one of the group, of the three. And Lamont Dozier, who's a Gemini also, like myself.
And like
yourself, that's right. He was just creative. He didn't have any borderlines, you know, as far as it wasn't ABC.
So when he left, what was his biggest hit? In fact, I downloaded a song that he sang.
Oh, yeah, well, he did one here before he left when he did with Holland Dozier Holland that I love, and that was Why Can't We Be Lovers?
That's the one I have, yeah.
I love that record. Love that record. There's a great alto solo on it, too, by Eli Fontaine before he passed. And he's the same one that did the solo work on What's Going On with Marvin, along with Wild Bill Moore on tenor saxophone on What's Going On Gone album with Marvin. But when we went to ABC, we did Try to Hold On to My Woman, and we did Fish Ain't Biting. Talking about Nixon and phase four and phase one and
political, huh?
Yeah, but it had a beat. And it was, some people tell me Greg Perry that produced the Honeycombs. Well, that was the other group too, we had the Honeycombs and Frida Payne at the company and several more very talented groups. But Greg came back and told me in L.A., I think he had been in Chicago, and they had been playing that record, Fish Ain't Biting. He said, man, and it's pre-disco in a sense. And he was just telling me how much they were dancing to that. And it was like pre-disco. And so it was like a kind of a, I know it'd be hard to hear it, but for some reason, he said they just love that record and everybody's dancing to it around the country. And that's why they put it out at that time, you know.
Wow, interesting.
Yeah.
So you started producing when you were with them?
When I went with...
you left.
When I left them, I started producing. But, you know, I look back and some people bring me records. A lot of the guys, you know, they study, they love vinyl. The people that love vinyl, and they go back and they bring me records. And I see that I was producing some things before I went with Motown. And I had just forgotten, because I was just doing whatever it was that day. Like some people say, well, we're going to go play baseball today. We're going to play basketball. Just walk around. Every day I was doing something in music. So a lot of the things, and it wasn't what really a design. It was just what I did. It's just what I love to do, and that's what I did. And so sometimes they bring me records, and I reflect back. I said, wow, I was doing arrangements before I got with Motown. Oh, I was producing. I was writing before I got with Motown.
You didn't even realize.
I mean, the credits are there, but I didn't think much about it. I just went to the next project. Like even now, you mentioned some of the artists that I work with. I've worked with so many various come to mind off the top of my head, and Paul did this with me too. And that was Pharoah Saunders. We did Pharoah Saunders. And Blue Mitchell on the jazz side, all the way to Johnny and Marie Osmond.
You worked with them?
Yeah, did work with them. With the Hollands, we produced an album on them. Clint Black, his wife, used to be a country western singer.
Yeah, I can't think of who it is.
When she was, before she married him, we did some stuff with her. And and I did a lot of, Jose Feliciano.
Really?
Yeah, I did Jose Feliciano also.
You mentioned something about...
Norman Connors, sorry.
Oh, Norman Connors.
Connors and
Michael Henderson?
Michael Henderson and all that, Starship Orchestra. Phyllis Hyman, Gene Karn, the Jones Girls was a group that I was managing. They're from Detroit.
Right.
And I was managing them, and I got them signed with Gamble and Huff out of Philadelphia.
Okay.
And so I was...
That Philadelphia, they had a sound.
Oh, had a great sound.
Uh-huh.
A great sound. I mean, I think Motown, we had our sound, which was connected with the soil and the people. And, you know, we all ate the same, we all breathed the same air, and it came out as reflected in the music, much like Philadelphia. I think there were three major sounds that were great at that time, and that was the Detroit sound, Motown sound, the Philadelphia sound, and the Muscle Shoals sound. This where Aretha did her stuff, and Sam and Dave, and Stax Records. You know, I think those three. Well, Chicago's always had the blues sound, so a lot of great talent there too. But Philadelphia and the Dice were very sophisticated, very very tame sound.
Well, when I think about the numerous artists who lived in Detroit. Just think about it. All the ones who lived in Detroit.
Right together sometimes, right in the project together, the Supremes.
Yeah, but even after they started making a little money, they were still here.
Detroit. Oh, yeah, that's true.
And then Dinah Washington lived here for a while. Yeah.
Oh, I used to go to her restaurant. Dick Knight Train Lane.
Lane, right.
I think it was on Linwood. Was it on Linwood, the restaurant?
I don't know. I was too young, but she lived on Leslie.
Yeah.
They
yeah.
lived on Leslie.
Yeah, yeah.
I find out these things. I mean, I wasn't trolling, but yeah. I just seriously loved it.
I saw Dinah. I didn't work with her, but and Dick, I was like Googled eye, you know, that's Dinah Washington and Dick Knight Train Lane, and
she had her own style.
Oh, for sure, Dinah Washington, for sure. And Gloria Lynn, I was thinking about I Wish You Love. Remember that one back
yes,
then?
Yes, yes,
yeah.
Yes.
That was a great. I was just thinking about the records that.
Well, you had something to do with one of Marvin Gaye's big albums.
Sexual Healing.
Sexual Healing. That's the one I was trying to think of it. What did you do with Sexual Healing?
Well, actually, I did the arrangements.
Really?
I heard a segment you did with Paul Reiser. Let me correct that. Technically, I did the orchestration versus arrangement. Because like Paul says, all orchestrators can arrange, but all arrangers cannot orchestrate. So that's the fact. Marvin was in Belgium, I think, and Harvey Fuqua called me and solicited me to do the horns for the project and strings. And Marvin, they sent the tapes to me in California. Marvin's still in Belgium. And I did the project. And then later, Marvin called me, because I used to see Marvin on the golf course up on 7 Mile. Yeah, and I was close to that area, and I would see him out there, but we weren't. I don't know if he knew my name or not, because he's a nice guy. I mean, if he knew you, it wasn't a thing, but we never had a chance to hang out because I would play the music in the studio and he wouldn't be there. He'd come in and sing later. But on this particular project, he called me later after we did the Sexual Healing project and said, Mac McKinley, where did you get those ideas? And I'm not very political, but I did think, I try to be truthful. I thought for a while and then I think I came up with a great answer, and I said, from you. and that was very true, because he was so creative that in the track, he might play an instrument, and he would go 4.5 bars, where generally you would go 8 or 12. He'd go 4.5, and then he would go to something else, randomly, just switch. But I would take that 4.5 bars and maybe develop it to its natural linear where it should be. Uh-huh. And then if he did something else, I would take that and make it another line. And he asked me, where did I get the idea? So I told him the truth. I got them from him. He loved the answer. And he hired me to do the tour with him.
Really?
The Sexual Healing Tour, which was his last tour.
That was a big hit.
It was? Oh, Sexual Healing, for sure. And it started a lot of things. I think After the Isley Brothers came out in between the sheets. And
yeah, I know, because you wouldn't associate with the Isley Brothers in between the sheets, which was a big hit.
Big hit, but Marvin Sexual Healer started.
He opened up all that. Yeah, all that romance. Well, not only romance, it was lust. His other stuff was romance, and then it became lusty.
Yeah, that's right.
But then again, one of my favorite albums by him was... the one, golly.
What's going on?
No, before, it might have been before or after that. It was one with getting high on a natural, and What's Happening, Brother.
What's going on, though. What's Happening, Brother, and What's Going On in the Streets.
That was.
Because, you know, all of that was a reflection of his brother, Frankie, having come back from the war. And Frankie was telling him all his story, and that's the genesis of What's Going On. That was the basic thing of What's Going On.
I have that. I guess I'm getting the albums mixed up, because that album in particular had that Ernie Barnes picture on it, the one I'm talking about.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. I'll tell you real quick. That was a great picture, Ernie Barnes.
They're dancing and everything.
And the shapes and the artisticness of it. And it reminds me of places I've seen down south, and when they start drinking and they've got the ham hocks going and they get happy. And that was After the Dance.
That wasn't the name of the album.
I Want You.
Yes, that was it.
Yeah.
I Want You.
I Want You. Yeah.
That album,
that
I love
album.
From the beginning to the end.
Great
and
album.
Marvin did his backgrounds on it.
All of it.
He did the background singing.
Yeah.
It was a masterpiece.
Yeah. It was. Now, you know, and it was. And Marvin did it all. But you know who did most of the writing on that?
Who?
I'll tell you. And it was supposed to be his album. And Leon Ware.
I remember that
Leon
name.
Leon Ware, yeah. He did a lot of things with Quincy, If I Lose This Heaven.
That's a jam.
And Leon wrote that. But that album was supposed to be for Leon. But they came to him and said, hey, you can put this album out on yourself and sell 100,000, or you can put Marvin on it and sell 100 million. So I don't think that was a hard decision to make. So, and that's how Marvin got on it, and Marvin did some of the writing. I think somebody else did some of the writing. His name will come to me in a minute. But Leon Ware was the writer on that. And that was a very, very good record, innovative sound. I tell you what, even when they talk about Rob, it's a different subject, but Robin Thicke, still,
Robin Thicke.
Yeah, Birdline. Right. If they go back and listen to some of his earlier works, Robin Thicke, they'll see where he was borrowing from Marvin all along.
Really?
And go back and listen to I Want You and his approach and stuff. When I first heard Silver's record, I said, that's Marvin. That's Marvin. The gay family just called me. The other day, their attorneys called me because they're still fighting that suit with the bird line and stuff.
Really? So, yeah. I thought that they were...
They resolved it, but they're contesting it, the Pharrells and the...
they're so, contesting. They do have some beats on there that sound...
Oh, for sure. When I first heard the record, I didn't even see the girls dancing and stuff. I just heard that music, and I said, that's got to give it up. Got to give it up.
So,
Another group, too, you might remember. We go a long way back. Bloodstone.
Yes.
That
we go a long way.
Well, that was my record, too. I produced that one. I had that record in my closet for about 2 years.
Really?
I just cut a demo on them. And Kitty Sears was a good friend of Ronnie Isley and then played it for the Isley Brothers. And so the Isley Brothers put it out. And that's how that record went.
I'm going to bring this up because a lot of my audience may not know that your son was Proof, the rapper.
True.
The rapper Proof. Looking at a picture of him right now, you can see how much they look alike. Yeah. Now, did he get his interest in music from you?
You know, they say genetically perhaps, but when he was a kid, I used to bring him out to California because I was living there. His mother was here. And I would bring him out every year. But I remember that Marvin and the Hollins and all of them said, get that little kid. He'd be running around the studio and darting between the mics and the whole bit. So he was exposed to the music for sure by being around me. And I remember I used to talk to him, and he told me he was in the music now. Before I knew what rap was, before anybody knew what it was. And I said, what instrument are you playing? Well, I'm not playing an instrument. Well, you're studying music, harmony and theory, counterpoint? He said, no. I said, well, what are you, you're in music, what are you doing? And I don't know if he said rapping or something, but he let me know that it was something he was doing that was brand new. And I didn't know what it was. Before the hippity hop and the hotel thing and what was the group that came out with that I know the name.
I got some young people in the studio. They should be able to tell it. But you know, Eminem, he was good.
Yeah, he was. Actually, they give him credit for exposing Eminem to the black audience and taking him around to the clubs and introducing him and said, "Get this guy a chance." As a matter of fact, unfortunately, when he passed, Eminem took care of everything. They had the reminiscence to me of the glass carriage and the whole thing, and every year they celebrate
Sugar Hill Gang.
Sugar Hill Game, yeah.
I just know Henry Tyler, you know.
Yeah, and it was before that, he was telling me about this stuff before then, because I didn't have any idea what he was talking about. I just took it as the kid had lost his mind. I just said, I don't know what's happened with him, but I didn't think he lost his mind, but I said, I don't know what he's doing if he's not playing any instruments. There's no music involved.
What
is he doing? And he says, well, he tried to explain it to me, I think, the best he could. And it wasn't his fault that I didn't understand. It was my fault because I wasn't open for it, you know. But like Eminem, so they really called him the mayor of hip-hop here in Detroit. And I've had so many people come up to me and tell me stories. Well, I'm very proud of him in that sense, that what he did for them, how he helped them. I never had anybody come up to me. I never really heard any stories how he maligned anybody or hurt anybody. It's always been a very
positive. And Mekhi Phifer's character played him
yeah, that's
in
right.
8 Mile.
That's true. And even now, every March 11th, 4/11, maybe April 11th, 4/11, they, which is the day he passed. They celebrate that here, the hip hop community, every year for 10 years,
wow.
And they do it here sometimes at St. Andrew's Hall, or they go to the cemetery. You know, he's in the crypt with Rosa Parks. next to Rosa Parks, because they had a controversy about him being buried there and stuff, but they resolved that. So, yeah.
And
so,
Eminem paid for that.
Yeah, all of his mother just passed on his birthday. She was buried on his birth on Sean's birth. Sean is this, the fruit is what they call him. I call him Sean, but they buried her on his birthday. It just happened that way, and she's in the crypt too. So Eminem took care of all of that, and plus I think he takes care of the grandkids and stuff too a bit. So
that's so nice.
Yeah, that is. Well, he's very appreciative of what Sean did or Proof did for him. So
that is so nice. But is, you know, I was just amazed how much you two look alike. It was just amazing to me. And so where do you see, you've done so much and we're not able to even cover it all on this show because I plan in February to have my special show with you and Paul Reiser back here.
That sounds good.
And yeah, because Paul, I mean, that day was just a coincidence when he was riding with you. Yeah. And I said, McKinley Jackson, politicians. I just jump on it because I'm really a fan, so we got a couple of minutes.
Guess what?
Yes,
I'm a fan of Paul Reiser.
Yeah, well, who isn't?
I mean, he's I think that's how I got to Motown to answer your question. I believe it was Paul that told him to call me in the first place, so I didn't mention that earlier, but
right,
he's a one of a kind.
And he's the one, well, you know, I had him on the show, and he does that intro for Papa Was a Rolling Stone. He got his Grammy for that.
That's right, yeah.
He got his Grammy for that, and he did the orchestration.
Yeah, he did, for sure. And I tell you, someone else was very instrumental to Paul and myself, and that was Johnny Allen. And Johnny Allen got his Grammy
He just passed not too long ago.
Right. He got his for Shaft. Isaac Hayes, the Shaft thing.
If that's a quick call, I could take it real quick because we... Oh, okay, it's not. I thought there was a call. But I want to thank you.
Oh.
This is just... the hour went by too quick. It's just about done. And but I told Mr. Reiser, I said, I want you both on so you all could just exchange stories. I could just sit back. And but I think that the world needs to hear about the background of the people who were also very instrumental in the music that came out of Detroit.
That's true. And like I said, overseas, they appreciate that, but here I don't think we get enough of it. And you need to have that because people need to know that there are other areas that you can go into in the industry without necessarily being a singer or a dancer or whatever.
There's so many and learn behind the scenes and all of that. And if you could be a good songwriter.
Yeah, that's right. And that was like a school back then. Unfortunately, with the way they're doing now with the budgets and cutting back the music classes in the public education.
That's the last thing I wanted to say, that you, Paul Reiser, Paul walked out of Cass Tech right into Motown. And Cass Tech still has their music program. But I was going to say that was a testament to the Detroit public schools
at that time.
They really looked at the all-around student.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, McKinley Jackson, thank you. This has been just wonderful.
Well, can I just say, Brenda Perlman, thank you.
It's my
my honor.
And I'm going to come see you all at Adiamos.
February 27th and 28th.
I'll probably have you on the show before then.
Hopefully.
Oh, yeah, I will. We'll do a special. Okay, everybody, we have table talk today, and we have some things to talk about and maybe some potluck, too. And I'll see you in just a few minutes with Table Talk with Daron and Ellis and me. Bye-bye.